actually started out in the industry. We just talked about this. Character artist for a local company called Geneva. And around 2007 or so, I became aware of this thing called technical art and found that it really appealed to me and very much seemed to resonate with the skill set that I, well, things that I enjoy and the skill set that I think that I have. And so in 2008, Geneva was gracious enough to let me transition into technical art. And it was late 2011 that I moved to Hi-Rez. And while at Hi-Rez, I've done everything from character rigging to custom tool creation, which is what this particular talk is about. And Hi-Rez, I worked on projects like Tribes Ascend, if any of you guys are familiar with the Tribes franchise, and more recently Smite, and actually several unannounced projects. And more recently, there's another unannounced project, which hopefully we'll be talking about around the end of the year, beginning of the next year. So the title of the talk is Tools to the Rescue. And you probably, it's possible that you went through the blurb in the program. It's very wordy, very verbose. To break that down a little bit, really this talk is about the fact that there are situations in games that routinely arise when the tools in hand are not adequate for the task at hand. And the consequence of that is that the production process suffers, and ultimately so does the final project. But the actual developers do also, right? We might have additional crunch time, or just stress from having to deal with tools that are subpar. So in this talk, we'll go over three scenarios in which custom tools addressed three problem situations. So you might ask yourself, why do we need custom tools? Especially in light of the fact that 3ds Max, Maya, ZBrush, TopoGun, all these programs do a really good job at fulfilling their role and they're getting better year by year. But I would argue that because they're kind of general purpose tools and they'll always be somewhat general purpose, I would argue that we'll always have a need to extend those tools and even come up with standalone custom tools that allow individual studios to get work done that is not explicitly supported by those packages, as good as they are. So custom tools, they can extend and enhance existing software. And as I mentioned before, custom tools can be standalone. But this talk is actually going to center around tools that, that require existing software. They can remove or minimize unnecessary grind, which of course contributes to the kind of the holy grail of content creation, better art. They can facilitate more iteration just by making that process more fluid, and again, that contributes to better art. And they can do wonders to improve content creator morale. And I don't have any studies to back up this idea, but I'm pretty confident that happy artists are more productive than artists that are less satisfied with the tools that they've been provided. And again, this should contribute to better art. Also, custom tools can increase the production speed, which of course makes it more likely that deadlines will be met. And all this, of course, ultimately leads to a better end product, which is everybody's goal. So here are three scenarios where custom tools are helpful. Three kind of broad sort of scenarios. And this list is not meant to be like many of the lists in this presentation. It's not meant to be comprehensive, but hopefully it contains a few scenarios that when we kind of go through the process of actually addressing those scenarios, you'll find some useful information in all of that. So the first scenario, the existing tool set, if there even is one, it's just not adequate to the task at hand. The second scenario that we'll go over, the existing tool set has become obsolete. There's a variety of reasons why that could happen. In the final scenario, the existing tool set works, but it's very marginal. It does just enough to keep the production process chugging forward. picture, I think, kind of encapsulates all three of those scenarios. So, you know, just to reiterate, the first scenario was no tool or no adequate tool. And I think it's pretty easy to make the case that the saw is not adequate for the job at hand. And the second scenario was the tool obsolescence. And again, that applies. A handsaw like this would have minimal application in modern modern. They have all sorts of really cool mechanized machines for that nowadays. And then the third scenario is existing tool is marginal. And so while it might be possible technically to actually saw down a redwood tree with a saw or maybe a box of hand saws, that would be the very definition, I think, of tedium. And so maybe there's some hyperbole in this image, but I think sometimes content creators feel like that's what they're up against. So before you begin developing a custom tool, there are some questions I think it pays to ask. So one of those questions is, does a solution already exist to the problem you're trying to solve? And if one does, is using that solution going to be better than rolling your own solution? I think sometimes it's easy to get very excited about the prospect of creating a new tool and kind of rush off and start developing it. You know, if that's your own project, that's fine. But if you're doing it on the company's dime, you want to make sure that you're only doing it if it actually makes sense for the company. Will the development slash maintenance of the tool be cost effective? So just some basic cost benefit analysis. And it's not just the cost of developing the tool, it's also the cost of fixing bugs, educating your user base, just updates, anything along those lines. So when you're designing a custom tool, let's say that you decided that in fact you do want to design one. There are some additional questions to ask. First of which being kind of obvious. What will the tool do? It's important to have a comprehensive list of what it should do before you move forward. Who will use the tool? If we're talking about power users, in that case you might want to expose more customization for the tool. Maybe more, maybe you've got a additional kind of parameters that you can tweak for the power user. If on the other hand, the user is more, maybe less technical, or maybe not in need of a power user type solution, it's okay to have that functionality. You might want to consider hiding it, not having it kind of top level. If a tool replaces some other system, you need to think of how you can improve upon that existing system or previous system while not compromising things in the old system do really well. And doing that actually makes getting your users to adopt your tool a lot easier, right? It's a much easier sell. You can tell them, look, it did everything the old tool did, and I've improved on this point and this other point as well. Also, how long will the tool be in use? This one is kind of tricky because I think a lot of times, in my experience, you put in place a stopgap measure and it ends up being a much longer term fix or solution than you originally thought or intended it to be. And in that case, I think sometimes it pays to over-engineer your solution a little bit so that it's able to kind of weather that additional time a little better. That's tricky because ideally the stopgap would only be a short term thing as intended, but sometimes the reality is it ends up taking place a lot longer. So the first tool we'll talk about, I've called the Active Material Batch Editor, or AMBE, for the purposes of convenience. So this tool was designed to address a scenario of the first kind, which was no tool or a tool that was just kind of inadequate for the task. So the problem this particular tool addressed had to do with one limitation that I ran into at Kineva. So Kineva's material system did not at the time support any kind of material instancing. And so all the materials for all the character assets were explicit, no kind of referencing. And actually they were tied to individual meshes as well. And initially this was somewhat manageable. Maybe we had a few hundred character meshes that we were working with. But you know, as the asset set grew in the thousands, it became really impractical. And to give you an idea, Microsoft mesh, you know, that actually had any skin on it, it had its own explicit material that needed to be kind of hand adjusted. And so you can imagine that was kind of a nightmare. And really kind of failing of the platform. And unfortunately, there wasn't any engineering bandwidth to deal with that. That would have been the ideal approach. And in addition to there not being any engineering bandwidth to address that problem, Kiva Editor didn't have any kind of scripting API, so it couldn't easily be automated by a scripting API built into the actual editor itself. So what I decided to do actually to resolve that issue was employ something called the auto hotkey as a means of actually automating that process of material creation and modification. And I'll use AHK just for convenience. So you may be curious about auto hotkey. You should be. It's a powerful free and open source scripting language. And this quote says for desktop automation, but in actuality, you can do everything from simple macro creation to full standalone applications with it. If you wanted to, you could create a word processor with it. It's probably not the best choice for that, but it does actually support that kind of functionality. So as I said, it's very versatile. The syntax is a little bit strange. It's kind of like a little bit like BASIC or maybe like bash scripting. So the syntax is kind of archaic, but again, it's very powerful and I think worth overcoming the awkward syntax. Another similar product, AutoInt, which is kind of a sibling of AHA, is another automation scripting language worth taking a look at. And I've provided a URL of just autohotkey.com. Curious about looking into that. So using auto hotkey, the solution that I came up with works as follows. So artists begin by creating XML-like material definition files using whatever text editor they're comfortable with. And these XML definition material definition files can hold as many materials as you want to put in. These definition files are then used to actually do the material creation or material modification. And so the process for actually using this works as follows. So you launch the Kiva editor, which is the predominant editor for the Kiva game platform. And then you launch an auto hotkey executable. And one of the really powerful features of AHK is that you can create standalone executables. Which means that you don't have to actually install AutoHotKey on the machine if you want to run an AutoHotKey script or program, which is really, really handy for deploying. Use a GUI that is generated by this AHK-based executable. And with this, the user just basically browses to the material definition file and specifies what objects, what set of meshes to modify materials on in the editor. At that point, you just sit back and allow it to automate the process. So this is not the most elegant of solutions. Kind of like this flashlight fix for these car headlights. Which might even be questionable even for a short-term fix. So just, you know, admission, the system was not elegant or particularly efficient. In fact, there were several instances where we had 2-3 computers running literally all night in order to do all this, batch material processing. You come in the morning with your fingers crossed, hoping that nothing had failed, right? And so it's far from ideal, but in this particular scenario, it allowed us to hit the deadline in a way that didn't drive the artists nuts. And so I feel like given the circumstances, it was not a bad solution all around. And I feel obligated to kind of share what I think is a more proper solution to the problem, a longer term fix, which would be to have engineering step in and actually pull the material data away from the mesh extra data and then actually set up a proper material instancing system. What I mean by material instancing, I probably should have said this up front, basically, with an instancing system, you can establish a small, relatively small number of kind of master materials and then build off of those, versus having, you know, each material be fully independent. So that would have been a better solution, but again, under the circumstances, it wasn't an option, it wasn't practical. So the next tool we'll talk about was created in order to address the second problem scenario, which had to do with a tool that became obsolete. This tool I'm calling NPX Character Export Pipeline. So a little bit of background. Hi-Rez Studios has used the Unreal Engine since 2005, since the company was founded. For most of that time, we've used Character Export Pipeline based on ActorX, which is an export pipeline that Epic, the company that is responsible for Unreal Engine, that is an export format that they actually created. And that worked really great for us, no complaints, until Epic actually deprecated ActorX in 2009, 2010, somewhere around that time frame. And actually, truth be told, it continued to work well for us, because we actually kind of limped along with ActorX even after Epic had deprecated it. But actually, earlier this year, we upgraded to 3ds Max 2015, and actually, because versions of 3ds Max post version 2011 have no ActorX support, but we're finally forced to finally, I guess, set aside the interval ActorX pipeline. So that meant that finally we had to replace it. We were forced to replace it. And so we elected to basically rewrite the pipeline, the character export pipeline, this time making use of Autodesk, their FBX file format. We did this first and foremost because it is the format that Epic has selected as being the principal of, I guess, the export-import format. So just to kind of compare and contrast ActorX and FBX a little bit, they have very different purposes, right? ActorX is a very kind of special purpose, kind of custom set of file formats that were designed really to kind of simply get character assets from your digital content creation program, whether that's Max or Maya, into Unreal. And by contrast, FBX is actually intended to be something much broader. It's actually meant to be, it's currently implemented, it's meant to be an interchange format between the various Autodesk products. And so that means it actually has kind of a much larger job of being able to support any kind of node that you might have in 3ds Max or it's not there yet, obviously, but that is the ambition. That's where they're trying to head with it. And so these kind of differences of purposes have implications. They have pros and cons. The con side, FBX files tend to be a lot larger than ActorX files that are their equivalents. And that's because of the stated, I guess, genericism and verbosity of the FBX file format. And this means, of course, that they open and save, read and write much more slowly than ActorX files. Also, because the ActorX files are asset type specific, you can just look at the file extension of the file and you'll know what content is contained there. So if you see a .psa file, a file with a .psa extension, you can know that it has animation, skeletal animation in it. Whereas every FBX file, regardless of the contents, has a .fbx extension. And that means you're probably going to have to actually be more careful about your naming conventions with FBX files. On the flip side, FBX is a lot more flexible in terms of what you can store in it, so it opens up a lot of possibilities in terms of how you move your content from the ECC application here to, in this case, Unreal. Also, FBX files can be re-imported into their source ECC application. And so if you're getting some kind of strange result when you import a file, you actually have the ability to bring that file back into Max or Maya, wherever it came from. And that's just another tool to kind of ascertain maybe what went wrong in the export.
ECC?
Digital content creation.
Okay.
So, and that would include, you know, anything that creates digital content, photos, .px files can optionally be saved in ASCII format, which is even bigger than the binary format. But the strength there is that you can kind of peek into the ASCII file. And again, it's helpful for debugging, or if you had some kind of, you could write your own parser, I guess. Although, I will say that it's made a little bit less useful because Autodesk is not releasing the official docs on MBX, the actual file spec. And that to me is kind of a big, I think I know why Autodesk is doing it, but it is kind of a black and white format. You know, for us as Epic shows that we, you know, we're stuck with the pros and the cons, but I think it is helpful to note that there are pros and cons. So goals for the new pipeline. So it needs to have all the functionality of the last pipeline where applicable. Again, we don't want to take any steps back in terms of functionality. And so this functionality would include batch and export. So, you know, exporting multiple animations kind of automatically, or skeleton meshes, whatever the asset type would be. It needs to support animation metadata and related functionality. So what I mean by animation metadata is we actually store information about each animation in max files containing animation data in the file metadata. And so this information is pretty simple. It's basically for each animation in the file, we're storing the name of the animation under the calls and animation sequences. The start frame, the end frame, also whether it actually loops. So the pipeline needs to be able to extract this information and export files accordingly. And it also needs to be able to use to support custom clean behavior. So I think it's a pretty typical thing when you're exporting animation information to have something, some kind of clean process where you actually remove unnecessary objects from the scene and perhaps bake some animation data. And we have a very generic process for that when we're exporting character animations. But there are some character rigs, especially in Smite, that employ functionality that requires some special handling when we're actually cleaning the rigs prior to export. So we needed to support that capacity. And it should be at least as easy and intuitive to use as the prior solution. And so kind of both of these main points, you know, maintaining functionality and improving upon it, maintaining ease of use and improving on that, kind of harken back to what we talked about earlier. In terms of giving users a better experience than what they had before. In the case of the FBX pipeline, the users didn't have any choice. They had to use it. It wasn't an optional upgrade. But still, I think you want to strive for making your tool as appealing as possible so that it's a more pleasant, I guess, upgrade for your user. So another goal would be improvements made where there's low-hanging fruit or where there's just kind of there's an obvious problem. And as for longer term goals, eventually we want to have better UE4 support. That's something that will come online. We're not using UE4 for any projects currently. We've experimented a little bit with it, but again, there's no kind of full-on development using UE4. But at some point we anticipate moving to UE4. And kind of similarly, we started to use Unity in a few in-house projects. And we're currently using the pipeline somewhat with Unity. But I envision we'll be using it more as time goes by. And so the pipeline is implemented in MaxScript, which is 3ds Max's built-in scripting language. It's kind of equivalent to Mel in Python. Although everything is kind of moving to Python, including 3ds Max. I did not use Python just because it's a little bit immature still within 3ds Max. Python has much better syntax than MaxScript has, and it's also fully object-oriented, which MaxScript is not. So eventually it will supplant MaxScript in the same way that Python has supplanted Mel and Maya, but it's going to take a while. It'll take several releases now, probably, before Autodesk gets it right. So I'm not going to get too far into the implementation details. But I did actually want to talk a little bit about how nodes are selected for export. So with ActorX, if you wanted to do a character export, You can simply select the character meshes in the file that correspond to the character that you want it to export, and then you can export that. FBX, on the other hand, requires that you explicitly select all the skin meshes and all the bones in the export hierarchy that need to be exported, which is, that's a little more onerous than what AfterX presented. So I came up with this notion of export node sets, which are really just sets of object names in a max file that basically pertain to a given character that needs to be exported in a scene. So at first the process required the user, in this case the rigger, to actually explicitly define, hey, it's going to be this character mesh over here, this skin mesh over here, and then this hierarchy of bones for this particular character. But in order to make it kind of match the ease of use of AfterX, eventually we simplified it so that the user only had to specify the actual skin meshes, and then the tool would actually derive the hierarchy of bones needed from those skin meshes. So this third tool, I think, will be maybe a little more graphic, which will be helpful, I think. And so it hails from that third category, where the tool is kind of marginal, not really, it's barely sort of getting the job done. Maybe you guys have seen this meme. This was posted by Steve Theodore, kind of a rock star tech artist in the industry. And I think it explains well one of the characteristics of good tech artists. I think good tech artists are lazy in the best sense of the word. I think a lot of times the idea for a tool hits us when we're personally confronted with a broken or frustrating process, and that was certainly the case with the mesh dipper. So at Hi-Rez, whenever we're creating a rig, there's a ton of data transfer that's needed during the process of creating a rig, and this is in the form of multiple character mesh iterations during the creation of the actual rig. And again, during the creation of the rig, we're very often subdividing up a character mesh into pieces and then recombining them in the end. So we might, for example, break a character into an upper half, lower half, or maybe even the head becomes a separate piece. And because of all this sort of, transfer of data, being obvious to me, it is bolded because I'm speaking personally, I had to deal with these processes, so it sort of lit the fire under me to come up with a better way. So the normal flow, well actually let me supplement that a bit. So you might be asking yourself why we have so many mesh iterations that show up when we're actually creating a character rig. And the reason for that is we're trying to parallelize a process that is inherently serial. So the process of creating a character is generally a very serial process. You've got the first step, and then you've got the next step, and the next step depends on what happened in that first step. And then you've got the third step, and the third step is very dependent on that second step. And so on. So the normal flow of the process is something like this for creating a character, right? Typically the character is concepted and otherwise designed, and kind of once that's fixed, then at that point a character model is created. At Hi-Rez, that means creating a high resolution sculpting ZBrush, and then once that's done, a little res mesh is created on top of that in 3ds Max. Once that little poly gateway mesh is done, then the UV work can begin. And once the UVs are created, texture and material creation will start. And you see how every step is dependent on all the steps that preceded it. It's a very linear kind of process. But all that said, I have to acknowledge that even in the normal flow of things, it's very typical that the process, the progression is needed from one step to another. So, for example, it's very typical that when you're doing UV layout, you'll discover redundant geometry or a hole in your geometry that you have to then go back to that previous step and then fix. And similarly, it's very often that when you're creating material textures, you find that you've got problems with UVs that require you to, again, go back in the process and address. So even in a kind of more typical environment, it isn't strictly linear, unidirectional process. But for us, since in Hi-Rez, since our goal as riggers is to get an animated rig to animation as soon as possible, we don't actually have the luxury to wait until this entire process is complete. And so that means during the course of creating a rig, we'll very often get multiple versions of this low poly mesh. And prior to UVs actually being created, for example. And so that means, again, we'll be getting multiple mesh iterations before we're actually to this point of fixed UVs and basically a final mesh. And so in addition to those multiple mesh iterations that take place, I mentioned before the idea of breaking up a character mesh. We do that to actually further parallelize the process of character production process. And so what that allows us to do is we'll take, for example, we'll take the lower half of the character, we'll give that to one rigger, right? And then we'll give, say, the upper body to another rigger, and maybe some secondary kind of peripheral parts for like a third rigger. And all these guys will work kind of parallel, more or less. And then these parts will be recombined, right, once or each time. So, which is not, see some strange things over there. It is an awkward process. It is. It's not the tip. Again, this slide here is sort of the normal flow of actually producing a character. If I had gone on to detail how rigging typically works, rigging would be after this last step. UVs are fixed, textures and materials are created, and you get one version, right? You get one version of the mesh and you can rig it and send it onto animation. And there would be essentially one rigger handling the entire process probably. They would create the rig and they would do all the skinning. But again, since we're pressed for time, we have sometimes as little as 2 weeks to turn around content. We will actually divide up a character mesh and divide up the rigging and the skinning between multiple riggers. And again, it is awkward. We've managed to find a way that makes it workable, but it is awkward. But anyway, all of this means that we have a lot of data transfer between mesh iterations and also more recombining meshes.
Does your versioning software actually check out parts of the mesh?
That's a good question. It doesn't. We use perforce, and so there's a lot of local content. Well, actually, what we end up doing, is we'll check in. So say I've got the lower half, right? So I'll be working the lower half, and I'll actually be checking in at interval versions of the file that really just have updates to the lower part of the character, and I'll just put the suffix in perforce, which are my initials. And those are temporary files that originally are gotten rid of. But yeah, you raise a good point. I mean, 3ds Max doesn't really support what we're trying to do very well, just kind of at a base level. And there's really a perforce. Because you don't do diffing and merging with binary files, right? You just don't do that. Alright, so one of the things I came up with. What's that?
It just sounds like so many ways to completely break that process.
Yeah, it's a very sensitive process, and we've gotten to the point where we're all experienced enough with it, I think, that it works for us. It's not ideal. I would never tell a studio this is how you should be building your characters. This is very much driven just by the production schedule. With Smite or it's a MOBA and the content updates need to be free to play MOBA. And so the content updates need to be frequent. And so whether you're talking about 2 weeks or 3 weeks, you have to be a little creative in how you address those. Just to be kind of candid, I think Hi-Rez could probably, one thing we could do to kind of, I think, make the situation better would be to just get further ahead in the process and have a little bit more content buffering between releases. But how this so often goes, if you're traveling at a breakneck pace, a lot of times there's not the opportunity to kind of, let's not release anything for a month, we'll build up the content. hopefully at some point we'll do that. I still think, I think there is utility in what we are doing by trying to make this serial process parallel. But I also think that it's not the only approach that we could be using either. But yeah, it is kind of awkward, full admission on that. So I came up with a tool that I call a mesh differ in order to make all this data transfer a little bit smoother. And it kind of comes from this notion of diffing and merging text files, which is something that, you know, the programmers have been doing forever, and even working on text, I guess. This seemed really appropriate to me. I think Edison gets kind of a bum rap sometimes. He was very, very forthright about taking other people's ideas and kind of running with them. And I think in that case, that's definitely what I've done here, is I've taken this notion of diffing and merging and kind of repurposed it, but it's far from an original idea. So for this one, I'm just going to jump right into a few demonstrations. And cross my fingers and hope that all goes as well. All right, so I apologize. I've got a pretty archaic version of Max installed on this machine. This is version 2011, which is what we were using prior to our upgrade in 2015. Which, by the way, is another challenge. I could have given a talk on upgrading the previous Max 2015. And just, you know, the sort of complexity around that. This first demo, we're going to basically going to use vertex ID to I guess transfer vertex position. So I've got a version of Anubis here. You guys might, some of you might recognize this guy. This is one of the skins for Anubis. So we've got one here where I've not modified the geometry. This is what he looks like in the game. And then I've got a version of him with geometry kind of hilariously modified. But I didn't change the vertex order, right? So this is something that would happen often in production. You would get a character with slightly different proportions, or just some vertex movement between mesh iterations. So if you wanted to actually sync up the position, what you could do is use the mesh differ to do that. So I'm just going to pick the original mesh. It's going to take a minute. There's doing some UV stuff that I don't actually need it in this case. But
so did that sort of thing happen because one artist decided to scale something and forgot to move it back or whatever?
Yeah, so sometimes it's a case of maybe from the art director. They got, you know, they got the directive of, hey, the feet are too small. And hopefully for us, it's make the feet thicker, so we're not actually talking about moving bones. In some cases, bones might need to be moved as well. And so what I've done is I've extracted a bunch of information here from this original mesh. Now I'm going to do the same thing for our modified mesh. This example makes me think that we need a big head. So I've got data from both of those meshes. Now I'm just going to do a diff. And I'm going to do the diff by, again, my vertex ID. Because fortunately, the vertex ID is not changed. So what I call here is a version of the mesh that should have vertex color denoting like the difference of screen. Green actually is meant to denote that there's no change. So I'm using vertex color to kind of give you a visual representation of what's changed there. So let me actually try that again and see if I can get the vertex color all the way. Oh, things haven't changed. And as the color become warmer, that is actually denoting like a larger difference in this case in position. So now that I've got the diff made, what I can do is I can pick either one of the models, let's say the original model, and then I can apply those changes. So based on what I'm selecting, so if I select a few vertices, let's say that we only actually want to keep the few changes. So I'm just going to select the character speed. Now we can apply the modded feet. So this was relatively easy because the vertex IDs didn't change. But very often they do change. Anytime you're working under like the you're applying it polys and doing a lot of mesh operations, it's really easy to change the vertex order. The second example using these. We'll go into transferring, in this case, skin weight information using not vertex ID, but vertex position. So I'm just opening up the layer manager here. Again, this is a character from Smite, also from the Egyptian pantheon. I'm just going to reset the tool. This time we're doing weight dipping. And I'm going to use vertex position. Basically match up vertices between the old version and the new version. So let me just extract. And again, I'll do the same thing for the new version. Which, just to reiterate, vertex positions haven't changed, the vertex IDs have changed. And if you look at this character, you'll see that all of her weight is coming from pelvis weight of bone. So she obviously does not have the flyable weight the original character has. She's shitty weight on this one. So you can see if I just kind of skip through the bonus here, she actually has complete weights. Alright, so I'm going to pick Mesh B, the one that has the changed IDs. In this case, the vertex count is identical, but this would work even if it wasn't. So say they added a backpack to her or something, or something else to the headdress, you can still transfer weight. So I'm just going to do the diff as before. This time it's going to be diffing vertex weight and not vertex position. A little bit longer because it's actually having to do a nearest neighbor search versus just using the vertex IDs. So now, if I run my little test animation with this character, you'll see that she's moving just from the pelvis. Probably not at all. And so she's following the pelvis. Nothing else at this point. But now that we've matched up the vertices, by position, what we can do is just select all of them and then apply the weighting from the original model. That should give us, there you go, so now you can see the proper amount of smooth weight. So we've got one more of our demo here, and then hopefully we can squeeze in some Q&A. So this is a problem we have that happens frequently at Hi-Rez and probably elsewhere. It's rare that we actually have the ability to have full finger articulation. You almost always have to mittenize the hands to one degree or another. Sometimes literally you're talking about almost like Lego hands, which is kind of sad because of the way, because of the real-time requirements of games, we're still having to do that from time to time. So I've got this hand mesh, and I've got original hand here that you can tell the last three fingers, the pinky, ring finger, and middle finger, have all kind of been, I guess, grafted into sort of one sort of uber finger, if you will, because they're going to be driven by a single bone chain in the actual final pair. But let's say you get a hand update, right, from your modeler, and you know what? He doesn't have those changes that you made locally to get the fingers together, so you can see there's a difference, right, between those two hands. And you know what? The vertex order has changed, so you can't just shift vertex order. What you can do with the mesh differ is you can actually match a person's bias, you need as well. So if I grab the whole hand here, and then I also grab the helium, and we go into options, and I go match for vertices by UVW for position. And then I can run a diff again as before. And you know I'm actually going to pinch it, which I'm going to actually do a wave in a diff position here. Like, this is the newest feature that needs to be added, so if anything breaks, this is going to be able to break. So again, we'll extract information from the old hand. Practicing information and go into options and match the vertices by for position. And let's cross our fingers to do a diff. Some reason it's been broken. But effectively, what I'm trying to show is you can dip weighting and position at the same time. And you can actually then either apply using A fully from A, fully from B, or you can actually blend in A to B, B to A. So if you want to take 50% of the new weights or something, and you can, or 50% of the vertex displacement, position displacement, you can. Yes, you have some flexibility.
So for someone who can't script that themselves, what would you ask for from your technical artist or your programmers? It's like, I need a tool, you know, how do you know the capabilities to even ask for in something like that?
That's a really good question. I actually think that a lot of times content creators, you know, artists aren't even aware, you know, that a better way exists. And sometimes that way already exists in the actual software that you just don't know about. Like, there have been several times where I've been talking to an artist, like, yeah, I'm really frustrated by this particular task. And I'll say, well, you know, that in 3ds Max, you can change this configuration, or there's this modifier, or whatever. And so they're in a situation where they don't know enough to know that they could benefit from something else. And I think if you're an artist, probably the best thing you can do is be really curious about everything and really experiment with it. Experiment with different programs, really dig into a program and learn it, learn the functionality that's there. And from a tool creator standpoint, I think it really pays to spend time with your artists, talk to them, you know, look over their shoulder and see what they're doing. And collectively you come up with solutions that independently neither one of you would have arrived at. So but that is a good question, because I do think a lot of times a person who's in need of a tool doesn't have the prerequisite knowledge to know that something can be done, right? I think for artists a lot of times programming is kind of seems like this sort of arcane magic or something. And so they, you know, they're not aware that something could be done instead of code,
right?
So yeah, I think that is actually kind of a challenge. And then not only knowing that you need a certain tool, but being able to describe it in a way that that the engineer, the tools programmer understands. I think those are definitely challenging things. Illustrations can be really helpful for that sort of thing. If there's a communication disconnect between art and tech, I think you know, having a whiteboard around is really, really useful for that.
So basically, whiteboard out the steps that you're trying to perform and see if they can make it faster or more efficient based on their point of view?
Yeah, but I mean, you know, just sort of frequently asking the question, is there a better way to do this? Because I think very often people get stuck in, this particular methodology works, it's painful, I don't like it, but it works, and so they don't bother to investigate whether there's a better way or, you know, talk to the tech artist that's assisting them, you know. Because you have to get to that first step, you know. You'd say maybe the first step is coming to the realization that a better tool is needed. Because I think a lot of times, and I think that's a problem with upper management too. I think very often they don't see the value of putting developer muscle toward a task like that. Well, you know, we have a process in place that kind of works, so why should we spend money to improve that process? You know. So yeah, I think as a tool creator, I think we have responsibilities in basically evangelizing the merits of custom tools and making sure that management and the artists that use our tools are well aware of the possibilities, right? So they do ask for, hey, I know that you can do this, so could you do this other thing as well, kind of thing. Because yeah, I think that's a big problem right now, is just being aware that there is a better way. You know, that they're not stuck doing the task the way that they've always done the task. Yeah.
And your AHK tool?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, is that more of a user-friendly kind of thing, applicable to almost any program that you can open?
That's right. So the question was, you know, whether AHK could be used for really any program or used with any program. And the answer to that question is yes. It can be, I mean, basically, you're using mouse and keyboard input to drive whatever program you want to drive. So, and it has all kinds of sort of safeguards and being proper window handle. Is that window actually accepting input and that kind of thing? So if you do it correctly, it's pretty reliable. If you don't do it correctly, then you can have clicks and input going to all sorts of places. You can pin those clicks and input to go to. But yeah, to answer your question, you can use it to drive anything. Some people use it to make their emailing routine faster, right? They could use it to very quickly send out a generic reply to somebody, for example. Yes, people use it to automate all kinds of tasks. And actually, a lot of people use it when they're playing games, right? So they'll actually macro key combinations and
make bots.
Yeah, you absolutely could make bots, and people do. And I wouldn't endorse making bots with AutoID, but yeah, I mean, anything that responds to mouse and keyboard input, you could automate with it. So it actually can be really useful for QA also, like Walls and Kiva. I actually helped the QA team there actually make use of it for QA purposes. So, you know, they've got essentially a virtual tester who's, you know, hitting the arrow key, clicking the left mouse button. And it supports really kind of rudimentary like image processing too. So if you need to click by, well, if you need to like analyze a frame or something, it's really, really slow, but maybe in limited application that can be useful.
For like, I guess, people who get raw files for photos, they have 1,000 of them, they've got to resize them and something else.
Absolutely.
Stuff like that.
Yeah. And like, you know, Photoshop's got to be a batching. I think GIMP, if you get the right plugin, probably is good at that too. But it's just kind of another way in which, yeah, you can batch process a bunch of photos, text documents. Oh yeah, I think we're out of time, right?
Is it?
Yeah, we're just out of time. So feel free to stick around. I'm not going to leave right away. And if you have additional questions, But yeah, if you have questions, just come.